We will have Progility's Rob Hirschman sharing his insights on Project for the Web versus Project Online. So Rob Hirschman is a partner here at Progility. He has over 20 years of experience leading enterprise project and portfolio management strategies and initiatives for large organizations. He has a deep background in project portfolio management, business process automation, and enterprise collaboration. Rob leads Progility's business development and client relationship organization and works closely with the firm's delivery team to drive real business outcomes and results for clients. So with that, I'm going to hand it over to Rob Hirschman. Rob, the floor is yours.
Hey, Sarah. Thanks, everyone. Hopefully this has been a really good day for everybody. Let me share my screen here. And as Sarah mentioned, we're going to be talking to you a little bit about Project Online, Project for the Web. What are some of the planning and selection considerations you should keep in mind? Sarah, can you hear me okay?
Yep, we can hear you just fine.
Awesome. So our agenda, we'll get through in the next 15 or 20 minutes. We'll go through some of the current Microsoft platform options that are out there. Chuck did a really good job of outlining the purpose and the mission behind each. We're not going to get too deep there, just to give you kind of a higher level on that. What is Project for the Web? We're getting a lot of questions of, you know, it's great, this is a new solution, but what really is the what is it and how does it operate? We'll walk you through some functional considerations and then planning considerations around these technologies. There we go. So as Chuck mentioned, there are really three technologies involved in work and project management at Microsoft. The team that builds Planner, builds Project for the Web, builds Project Online. So we're really focused on, you know, Project Online and Project for the Web. And how do you make a decision what direction you're going to go, one, the other, or both? Project for the Web is really the coming together of what a lot of changes over the last 5 years. And I'd say there's really three primary changes in the marketplace that drove Microsoft to build Project for the Web. The first is really the adoption of Agile and calling for much more flexible ways to work as Agile methodologies started to take hold, whether it was Safe Agile or Basic Scrum, you know, the rise of tools like Jira in the marketplace and organizations driving towards Agile versus a traditional waterfall methodology. And the second demand that was really there around Project for the Web is the proliferation of pure web-based lighter project management tools. So we saw this trend, as Chuck talked about, towards the casual project manager. That really was sped up by the adoption of cloud software as a service technologies that are out there, where you could literally go swipe a credit card and start using that technology. And this is where we see the rise of technologies like a Smartsheet or Asana or a Basecamp. And this is really where the roots of Planner was about 5 years ago. Microsoft didn't know Planner would suddenly have 20 million users, but Planner now has 20 million users. So it's a really exciting change in the marketplace. And that's really sped the building out of technologies like Project for the Web. You know, I think the third move in this space really has to do with the maturation of tools you see at the top, your traditional PPM tools like Project Online. What's happened is you've seen consolidation in this market. A lot of the bigger players have bought other players. You know, Microsoft has kind of driven a big part of this market as well. And so what that's done is you have, really less innovation in that space because you have the bigger players kind of owning the market. And this has really kind of opened the marketplace to this middle tier for smaller, lightweight products that can certainly grow out there. So if you think about it, kind of new innovation, new expectations, that's what Project for the Web is really all about, with Project Online kind of sitting at the top of that heap. And, you know, if you start to line these up, I think if you're thinking about, you know, which direction do I go? You know, we've got Project for the Web on the left and we've got Project Online on the right. We have to first start taking a look at our target users. Who are they? Now, these two tools are really designed for different audiences, as Chuck talked about. The occasional business or kind of part-time project manager versus a formal project manager that follows a process and a methodology that's in a PMO. It's always about selecting the right tool for the job and implementing that. And if you select the wrong tool and try to implement it in the other environment, you're going to have a lot of challenges. For instance, you know, I think if Ned's team went and selected Project for the Web and tried to implement that with some of their processes and the discipline they have, it would have been very, very difficult to do. You know, from a platform perspective, you also want to start taking a look at, you know, where are you going on the platform? Are you comfortable with SharePoint Online? Are you moving to a full power platform approach? Which one are you more comfortable with, one, the other, or both? Functionality is really, really important here. And typically functionality, that third one down, is typically what drives the selection for most organizations. Do you need very, very basic high-level scheduling capabilities? You don't have a lot of maturity. You don't have formal project management processes. You just want to build a schedule, visualize it, and then extend that and build an app around that over time. Or are you looking for more defined processes and procedures you see on the right, like portfolio management, resource management, you want to do time management and time tracking, you know, issue and risk management, intake and demand management. That's going to help you select what the right platform is. Also, Microsoft Teams, we're seeing kind of the move to Microsoft Teams is, think of it as the operating system of the future, where more organizations, because really what happened with COVID and speeding the use and adoption of Teams and Zoom as platforms, people want to drive their users through that platform. So now from Project for the Web, we can enable access to the schedule, to the roadmaps, any of that information through core native apps. Project Online, we could do something fairly similar. It's just not native. We have to go and we have to configure Teams to meet Project Online kind of in the middle and provide information through different tabs. And finally, from a user interface and database perspective, there are different data sources here. On the left for Project for the Web, as Chuck had talked about, you've got the Dataverse database, which is the database behind Microsoft Dynamics, which is where all the data in Project for the Web is stored. So it's a pure web O365 architecture versus on the right. Again, you've got the web, you've got the Project Desktop client. Ned talked a little bit about how the interaction works there. You've got integration with that. And then you've got a SQL Server database in the back end that you're accessing data from. So you definitely want to think about kind of these five core components of the solution and figure out, is one a good fit, the other a good fit, or maybe I want both based on my environment. And more we're finding more organizations have a need for both. There's a need for the occasional or business project manager and maybe a marketing or finance or operations group. And then there's a need for more formal project and portfolio management, maybe in an IT or an innovation or a product development organization. And that's okay, because as Chuck showed you, you can really bring these worlds together through roadmaps, home, and reporting. So again, just summarizing Project for the Web, modern, simplified project management, schedule-based, very light scheduling, but also visualization in Kanbans and timelines as well, your traditional Gantt charts. And if you think about Project for the Web, there's really two components. And Chuck had kind of pointed to a couple of those with that project app. In Project for the Web, you've got the core service. And this is the web-based scheduling tool. And this is what's hooked up to that Plan One license Chuck talked about. You've got access to the project home, which is going to give you quick and easy access to your projects. You've got access to project roadmaps, which you need a Plan 3 license to build, but anyone in Office 365 can access those if they're given access. So you actually don't need a license to go in and look at roadmaps as long as you're a licensed M365 user. And this is what Microsoft and we're calling the green user interface, where you're going to build a project schedule. And that's about all you're going to be doing, a very basic use case. As Chuck mentioned, from a futures perspective, you got team member task updates coming, you've got more advanced scheduling, which may be tied to a different license, and then you've got the concept of resource bookings and resource management, which again is kind of downstream where Microsoft may be headed with the platform. Once we enable access to this through the Project Power app, we deploy what's called the accelerator, and this is going to extend the core Project for the Web functionality out into the Power platform. So we're actually going to access it through a different UI and a different window. This is where we're going to be able to go and track project-related information. If we wanted to track issues or risks, maybe check changes or status or costs, any unique metadata about projects we wanted, we can configure that in the form of an app and deploy that app to different users based on different profiles. So think of it as really a platform you can build an application around. If you didn't want to build kind of commercial off the shelf, you want to go with something where you're building it unique to your organization. Licensing-wise, this is always important. You need a Plan One license to go in and update content on your projects. And it includes what we call five custom entities that you can build on top of this. They could be things like change requests. They could be things like invoices or billability and things like that. So you can build custom entities on top of this because it is built on a database. This is what we call the purple UI, where you're going to be going into the native Power Apps user interface for things like your project schedule updates and all of your content. In the future, again, that's going to include some of the resource management functionality. That's kind of the overall direction Microsoft's headed. Specifically what we're building, we're not sure. But the key here is that Project for the Web lives on that Dataverse database. So whether you're going very core or you're going Power App, understand that's going to be in a different database than Project Online, but you're going to be able to access all this data through Power BI. Project Online, again, you've probably seen this a couple of times. Full portfolio management, full resource management, full demand management, full execution on the bottom right, detailed scheduling, time and task management, reporting on that. So if you need the full PPM, that's where Project Online is a great fit. If you're trying to do very starter level or kind of base, kind of entry level EPM, Project for the Web may be a good fit. And there are other options there, kind of hybrids in the middle. But, how do we want to start thinking about this from a functionality perspective? How do we want to compare one to the other and think about what do we need? So the first question we think you want to ask is, do we need enterprise level project and portfolio and resource management on one end, or a more basic business project management environment? If you think about it, they're really two different sets of requirements, two different sets of users. And you want to think about which is the right fit. What do I need from a business process and a functionality perspective? That'll drive what's the right tool for the job. Secondly, and this is important, do I have, or do we as an organization have the internal skills and resources to take advantage of one platform for another or another? You may be very, very experienced and skilled in a SharePoint and SQL environment, and that's great because you can already support what Project Online offers. Dataverse and Power Apps and that whole platform may be brand new. You're going to have to ramp people up on supporting that, because at the end of the day, you are supporting another application in your environment. Even if you're going kind of lights on with the core service, there is a database behind it and people are going to want reporting out of it. So you want to start to think about, do we have internal skills in one or the other, or are we building skills around one or the other area? What's our overall direction? And finally, you know, can we support that traditional SharePoint-based environment versus more of a Power Platform? And that's just not about the application. It's about governance. It's about, you know, what environments are we going to be setting up? What is the overall architecture going to look like? How do we support it from a functional and technical perspective? Planning that out as well. So think about, you know, skills and resources to take advantage of a platform and skills and resources to support the platform as well. And that's all driven by functionality and your organizational investments. But if we're thinking about planning this out, you know, what are some of the first things we want to think about if we're going down the road of a deployment? It always begins with the core business problem. You know, what is the business problem we're looking to solve? Then choose the tool or tools based off of that. A lot of folks come to us and say, I have a Plan 3 license. What can I do with it? Well, we'll back up and say, well, what are your problems? What are the outcomes you're looking to achieve? You know, then we can talk about what the technology can do to address those outcomes. So think about it as the problem statement first, then let's select the technology based on the problem you're looking to solve. And also, as some of the folks before mentioned, you know, putting a good process in place is really, really important. The tool isn't going to solve the problem in and of itself. Whether you're going with Project for the Web or Project Online, you want to assume a similar deployment lifecycle. And Rinky went through the deployment lifecycle that Santa Clara had, which is design, build, test, deploy, train, pilot, and then start to iterate and roll out to other groups as you meet with them, include their data, and then update the system as well as the data with the users. So make sure you're onboarding users in a scaled way. Whether you're using a very simple project for the web with a Power App, or full Project Online, you want to go through a very, very similar life cycle. It's an application you're rolling out at the end of the day. So just because someone went out and swiped a credit card and started using Asana doesn't mean they have a good design behind that system. They're just using what that tool can do. And most organizations have very, very unique ways they use the tool, as Todd mentioned before. So think about analyzing, designing, building, testing, training, piloting with an initial set of users, and then having iterations on top of that at that same life cycle. That's really a recipe for success with whatever direction you're going. Importantly, you know, with the proliferation of all these web-based tools, the proliferation of Agile in the marketplace and other tools, it's becoming very, very normal to have multiple applications to do project management. The concept that one tool will fit everybody in an enterprise, especially large enterprises, just doesn't hold anymore. It's just not the way we work. It's not the way the market is going. And even if you look at Microsoft, I mean, they right now have, if you look at Project for the Web, Project Online, and Project Operations on top of Planner, there's three or four tools there that could meet different requirements you might have. So you're always going to be going forward. You're not going to have one tool for the job. You're going to have multiple tools, whether it's Project, Azure DevOps, Planner for some lighter users, Project for the Web for kind of the middle tier there, Jira for a lot of your development teams, lots of different tools for the job. You have to be prepared to support that, but also think about, how am I going to allow this data to pull together and integrate? And a great strategy behind that, really, we think, is reporting, not necessarily integrating between five systems that are always changing, but always thinking about kind of, can I put Power BI on top of this, mine this data and report on it in a useful way to make business decisions? What data do I really need to do to make decisions? Importantly, remember, you know, as Chuck mentioned, you know, will Project Online be replaced at some point? Probably. It isn't going away in near term, but the future where Microsoft is headed is Power Platform, which is a fairly new platform for most organizations with Dynamics and Power Platform. So the timing is all TBD, but start to think about, you know, can I start to adopt, you know, Power Platform applications? We have some organizations that are using Project Online, but we're building Power Platform and Power Automate applications around that right now and adding business processes into that, with Project Online being kind of the core service. Other ones are going Project for the Web with a Power App, and we're building services around that. So you have lots of different options. The key is, think of it as a platform where you can select the different components based on the needs and the requirements that you have. And this is something you definitely want to start thinking about. Also, you know, we talk about Teams being the platform of the future. It's really, really where things are headed here. So think about, whatever I'm building, can I enable that in Teams? Can I provide visibility in Teams? Can I provide reporting in Teams? Then you're unifying that into a single user interface. So it's not only coming through Office 365, it should somehow flow through Teams. You know, we're building several applications for clients right now where it's Dataverse for Teams. So literally you go into Teams, you click submit a request, the data is stored in the Dataverse, but everything, all the forms and the workflow and the reports all happen in Teams now. And that's really kind of where the industry is headed overall, looking at Teams as that unified user interface or that hub for all of your applications. And project management is no different. And you know, if you are looking for robust PPM, if that is in your roadmap, you want to do all the stuff, all the functional stuff we talked about in the two circles, let's have a conversation. It's something that's not something you light up and go forward with. Even if you're starting to kind of in the mid tier, you want to do crawl or walk or run. You know, you really want to, as Todd mentioned before, plan this thing out. Plan out a rollout that's reasonable, where you have resources, people, and budget, and a reasonable amount of time to onboard your users with whatever solution you're going with. So think about it. If I'm not going robust, you know, make sure you reach out to some experts who can help you with this stuff. So Sarah, I think we're wrapping up here. I wanted to hand it back to you for any Q&A folks might have.
Great, thanks, Rob. So is the Power Platform what Teams runs on? If moving to Project for the Web, would this make integration with Teams easier?
So Teams is actually built on a SharePoint foundation, but the Power Platform behind the scenes is designed to plug into Teams. So what Microsoft is doing now is if you build a Power app, there's something called Dataverse for Teams, and that allows you to build Power apps that leverage the Dataverse, but your user interface is Teams. So Microsoft is starting to bring those two worlds together. While Teams isn't built on the Power Platform, the Power Platform is an enabling technology that can be plugged into Teams. Think of it that way.
All right, thank you. Another question. What are some of the challenges you are seeing from customers using Project for the Web and the Accelerator because it's so new?
That's a great question. You know, we're seeing, you know, Microsoft is still, it's a work in progress. The Accelerator is only about 5 or 6 months old. Microsoft is still working on documentation around it. So if you wanted to find detailed documentation on specifically how things function in there, it's not out there yet. You know, that's still a work in progress. Microsoft, as Chuck mentioned, their development cycles have changed. They're rolling out functionality, they're listening to users, and they're updating that functionality. So that's a lot different than the drop it and wait 3 years. So a lot of the challenges we're running into really have more to do with what's not known, what's not out there, and just being more exploratory with those projects than in Project Online, where everything is fairly well documented. The other challenge is walking into organizations that have no background or no experience with the Power Platform. It is a Power Platform application with the Dataverse behind it. So you really have to, we come in and we'll say, well, what environment do you want it going into? And what's your overall governance strategy for Power Platform? And where's the Dataverse database and things like that? And they don't have answers to that. So you have to at least sit down and come up with what your strategy around Power Platform is going to be. If that's already in place, architecturally, it'll fit in really, really nicely. If it's not, there's going to be a lot of open questions there. And how are you going to support this application? Because it's probably going to be the first of many Power Platform applications that are out there. So I would say it's really on the kind of the supportability side, the architecture side, and then kind of evolving documentation and evolving features. Those are kind of the big three things, the challenges we're seeing.
Thanks, Rob. I know you kind of already respond to this question. Is Power Platform what Teams runs on? I know you said it was SharePoint, but if moving to Project for the Web, would this make integration with Teams easier?
So trying to think through the question here. Project for the Web integrates with Teams today. You can go in and click on the project icon, the project app, point to a specific Project for the Web project, and then it will show up in Teams. So there is that integration that's there already, but that's just going to show you the schedule. If you wanted to go and actually point to the Power app, it doesn't natively do that. You'd need to go out there and actually link into that. So it's partially integrated with Teams today, but you're going to see more and more of that integration going down the road with Project for the Web. So.
Awesome. And we use Project Online. Can we leverage Power Platform apps with Project Online?
Absolutely. Yeah, Power Platform is really designed to build applications on whatever applications you have today. So we have some clients we've built like financial management, you know, capturing financials on projects, storing them in Power Platform with Dataverse, but that's linked directly into your Project Online, and then you have integrated reporting. You can absolutely do both, you know, Power Platform as well as Power Automate for any kind of workflows for, you know, issues, risks, changes, things like that. So absolutely, it's really designed to work together with Project Online.
Great. And I think we have one more question for you, Rob. It sounds like we still need to plan a deployment for Project for the Web, as it's not a lights on solution. So things like training users, capturing business needs, and all of that. Is that right?
That's correct. Yeah, even if you're going for really basic use cases, I would sit down and do some kind of analysis on what people want, document that, and then run through some test runs on that, especially if you're using the accelerator. That's definitely an application in and of itself. So you definitely want to go through that design, build, test, deploy, and then pilot lifecycle and training as well.